Easter, everyone. Glad you're here today. Thanks for coming. I know there's some guests that are here today. We bless you. We honor you. Thanks for being here. If you've come from another church today, we just bless your taking the time to be with us. We're a little bit proud of our family. We love Cross Point. We love what God's doing through this family. And we're just glad you get to be a part today. And we're glad we get to be a part of your life. So thanks for hanging with us. Some of you might recognize that Pastor Craig and Renee Osborne aren't here this morning. You might be watching on Facebook that Faith, their daughter, 11-year-old daughter, had a pacemaker placed inside of her heart this past week. And glad to report, she's doing phenomenally well. The doctors, come on. That's pretty cool. We've been praying that she would just kind of like, the doctors would go, wow, she's kind of like a strong little kid. And she really is. They've been saying that she's really recovering quickly. And she's out of ICU, and now she's in a room, and she's doing better. She's doing well, actually. And I think Josiah was here. Is he still here somewhere? Josiah! Josiah's here this morning up here on the platform playing bass. And we just pray blessing on the Osbornes as they spend time with Faith and just get her to recover quickly in Jesus' name. Get her home and get her back here. Amen? All right, well, thanks for coming again. Let's spend some time looking at what God's Word has to say for us. Easter is always a fun time, no matter how you slice it and dice it. Across this nation, we recognize that those that are Christ's followers are celebrating this Resurrection Sunday. And if you take away the resurrection from Christendom, we don't have Christendom as we know it today. We have not just another religion. Now, I'm here to report to you today that what you experienced even in worship today does not reflect dead religion. It doesn't. It reflects the heart of a people that are passionate for a living God, for a living Jesus, for a Holy Spirit that lives inside of us. And this morning, I want to take some time to talk to you. We're starting a series today called The Trump Card. And funny as it is, we received, I think, only one, maybe two calls that came in that were a little bit ticked off that we would actually use the Trump name on a card like this one to invite people to come. And I have news for you today. It has absolutely nothing to do with the President of the United States. I just want you to know that. But we are going to be talking for the next few weeks about this idea of the Trump card. I'll explain it in just a little while. But this morning, I want to begin by taking to you a passage of Scripture that I came across. I feel it's very appropriate for this morning on this Resurrection Sunday. Now, I'm gonna let you know right off the top that at the conclusion of the message today, we are going to give you opportunity to come to the front, and we want to give you an opportunity to be prayed for. And you'll find out in a moment why. But there's some of you today that need a touch physically in your body. We believe in divine healing. We believe that Holy Spirit is here today to touch your body physically. We've seen signs and wonders that have followed, and we're going to look a little bit at this today because it's not stopped, as some believe, when the disciples of old died and went to heaven and were martyred for Christ. Many believe that that age of healing and restoring physical bodies is over. It's not over. It's still happening today. We see it. A few weeks ago, believe this if you will, I saw it with my own eyes on the front row of our church. I saw a number of people that had one leg or the other that was longer or shorter. I saw the legs come together like this. Saw it with my own eyes. Believe if you will. But I believe that that's for today. We want to pray for you today. And some of you today might even say, you know, my life isn't exactly where it needs to be. And today I want to make a commitment to follow Jesus. So I'm just going to let you know up front that we're going to do those two things at the end. Now, let me get into what I want to talk about today a little bit. The Trump card is the name of our series. But today I want to talk about what have you seen? What have you seen? In Luke chapter 5, if you have a Bible, you're welcome to go there. Luke chapter 5. We're going to be looking at verses 17 through about 26. I'm not going to read them all right now, but we will cover those verses throughout the next few minutes. But I want to begin with verse 26. I'm going to springboard from verse 26, and I'm going to take you on a little journey. We're going to come back to verse 17 and take you through the scenario, the story that we find here about a paralytic that was healed. Verse 26 reads this way. It says, "And amazement seized them all, and they glorified God and were filled with awe, saying, we have seen extraordinary things today. We've seen extraordinary things today. You know, oftentimes, what we've seen in the natural with our own eyes or we've experienced in our life's journey actually helps to form our faith focus. In other words, how we view the world and how we view God and how we view other things comes, if not most in part of, because of our experiences in life. Would you agree with that? So some people have had a little rougher journey than others, and based on our life journey, we develop beliefs, we develop principles of living, we develop a worldview based on those things. I want to take you on this journey because I believe that God wants to enlighten you this morning, to awaken you to a greater truth, and that the God that we serve and the God that potentially lives inside your heart wants to use you in a measure, in a way that you probably have never thought he wanted to. If you've been around Crosspoint long enough, you'll know that most of us believe that God wants to use us in extraordinary ways. But for most of humanity, most of culture, they don't believe that God wants to use little old me. They believe sometimes he's so far away that this relationship that we're talking about, he's so far away, there's no way that I could have an intimate relationship with God the Father. And I say to you this morning, absolutely 100%, he wants relationship with you. And not distance relationship, he wants intimacy. He wants to walk with you because he knows you better than you know yourself. We sang the song this morning that really talked about that. They have the opportunity to really grow closer and closer in intimacy and relationship with God. Now, check this out. In Acts 19, who's actually the author of Luke, we believe is Luke, Dr. Luke. We're going to look at Luke again, his gospel in just a moment. But Acts 19, 11 and 12 says this. Check this out. Dr. Luke says it this way. Let me turn there real fast. 19, verse 11 and 12. And God was doing extraordinary miracles. Say extraordinary. Another way of using that word is extraordinary. And God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hands of the Apostle Paul, so that even handkerchiefs, aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Check this out. In Luke's narrative, in just a moment, we're going to look at another miracle that took place, but I want to set you up for what I believe God's trying to speak to us this morning about the extraordinary. Let's go back for a moment and explain to you what this idea we find here in, back to Luke chapter 5, when it speaks of extraordinary things. So in verse 26, an amazement seized them all. What I want you to understand is in this verse of scripture, the word amazement is amazing in the original language. Check this out. It's not a simple word or a weak word. The word amazement found in verse 26 in the original language of Jesus' day meant this. Take out of regular position or standing and bring into a state of ecstasy, like a person carried out in a trance-like amazement. The state of mind that reaches for beyond the powers of ordinary perception. In other words, it's a displacement of the mind, quite literally a state of ecstasy. Now, keep in context, we're building a storyline around Luke 5. It says in verse 26, an amazement seized them all. No question, when you look, and we're going to look at in just a moment what happened in Luke chapter 5, something profound, extraordinary took place. But to bring even greater emphasis to what happened here in this passage of scripture, it says this. It says, amazement seized them all. They take the word amazement, ecstasy, and they add this word seized. What does that look like? The word seized simply meant this word. It says it takes hold of that, it takes hold of something. It takes hold of and grips them. So when we read that amazement seized them, it is saying that they took hold of that which they saw and personally experienced. What was it they experienced? Extraordinary things. Dr. Luke in Acts talks about extraordinary miracles to the degree that the Apostle Paul was so full of God that literally a piece of material could touch his skin. They took the material and they would go pray for people and place the material on the people's skin and they would be what? Healed. How many know that's extraordinary? How many know that would grip us in a way that we'd probably never been gripped before? How many know that we, if we saw this morning someone raised from the dead before our very eyes, we would be literally in a state of ecstasy? It would displace what our rational mind would suggest. We look at that and go, there's no way possible that person should be alive. But now, because of the profound experience we've had and what we've seen with our own eyes, now we could potentially be in a place of like, oh, are you kidding me? Extraordinary things. Extraordinary things. In John, the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 12, it says some very cool words. It says this, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me, Jesus, in me will also do the works that I do. Doesn't stop there. And greater works than these will he do because I'm going to the Father. This is such a great thing for us to understand on Resurrection Sunday. That it is extraordinary that Jesus died on the cross for you and I, and 3 days later came out of a tomb alive and well, and walked the planet for 40 days, and then he went to be with the Father in heaven. But he says these words. He said, when I go to my Father, those of you that believe in me will do greater things than I did. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm kind of ready in the life and the culture that we live to begin to see such extraordinary things that it causes even the person that absolutely has no faith in God or anything looks at something that happens because of your life and who you are and the God that you carry, and they look at that and they go, this is crazy. And they've been seized. They've grabbed a hold of what they've seen with their own eyes and what they've experienced in their own life. What this country needs and what the church needs and what the world needs more than ever before is when you and I begin what the Bible calls as sons and daughters, we begin to believe what God said about you and me, and we begin to do the greater works that he promised. Do you know he wants to use you? He can use you to pray for someone, and literally in that moment of your faith being activated, they can be healed of whatever the condition. If God can take a piece of material that was on the body of the Apostle Paul, and they could take that piece of material and they could go lay it on somebody's body and then be healed of whatever it is, I promise you, in today's culture, God can use you without a piece of material. All he's looking for is a little bit of faith. All he's looking for is someone that actually believes that God can use me to do the extraordinary. The problem is sometimes we've seen some amazing things. We've seen some amazing miracles. But it hasn't changed our view of the world in which we live. It hasn't changed us from the inside out. We might believe that's good for someone else, but not for me. Well, I'm here this morning to encourage those that have been walking with God a long time and those of you that may be on a brand new journey. That the Father is calling us today to walk like we've never walked before. It's amazing when I go back to look at Acts 19. Now look at this passage of scripture where Dr. Luke explains these extraordinary miracles. And I want to give you context. And I'm going to go back to Luke 5, walk you through the story, and find out why verse 26 says that these people were amazed at what they'd seen because of the extraordinary things that took place. I believe God wants to do some extraordinary things in your life this morning. It's amazing when you think about Paul, the apostle, was about, it was really about the one inside of the Apostle Paul than what was going on the outside. Some of you know that he was the largest persecutor of Christians. This dude was the kind of guy that while others that he may have contracted to be like assassins, but stand on the sideline and watch them being abused and tortured and killed. And while he was watching them, he would hold the clothing of those that are doing the torturing. Never did the killing, but was always around it and was the one that persecuted and got people to do the work. This is the guy we're speaking of. He was the worst of the worst. Yet here we read from John's gospel narrative that was so full of God that pieces of clothing that touched his skin were used to bring healing to others. He went from this guy that was persecuting the then known church to a guy that now a little piece of fabric can bring healing to somebody's body. If God can do it to the Apostle Paul, he can do it to any of us in this room. And God wants to do it. I don't care how long you've been serving God. Man, I've known people that have been serving Jesus for 30, 40, 50 years, have never prayed for one person because they don't believe that God wants to use them. It's a lie of the evil one. I promise you, it's a complete deception. Doesn't matter where you are in your journey, God wants to use you if all you will be willing to do is say, yeah, dude, I'm willing to do this. Now, let's go back to Luke chapter 5 real fast, and let me just spend a few minutes there, and then we're going to pray for you, and then go home and eat lots of food, take long naps, very long naps. In Luke chapter 5, let's go to verse 17, and let's put some context now behind what happened in verse 26. Here's the story. In Luke chapter 5, verse 17, on one of those days, as he was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and from Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with him to heal. And behold, some men were bringing a bed to a man who was paralyzed, and they were seeking to bring him in and lay him before Jesus. But finding no way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the roof, let him down with his bed through the tiles in the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said, man, your sins are forgiven you. And scribes and Pharisees began to question, saying, who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? When Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answered them, why do you question in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or rise up and walk? But that you may know, verse 24, that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. He said to the man who was paralyzed, check this out, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. And immediately he rose up before them and picked up what he had been lying on and went home, glorifying God. Now read verse 26. And amazement seized them all, and they glorified God and were filled with awe, saying, we've seen extraordinary things today. It's believed that where Jesus was gathered was the home of Peter, the Apostle Peter. And the people were in the Apostle Peter's home. They were just crammed so tightly together around the door, inside the walls. It was just crazy full of people. The men look at one another, and they begin to hear the hustle and the rustle above them. And they go, what shall we do? And one points to the roof because they saw what was going on. And above the living quarters, houses in Palestine, typically they all had flat roofs surrounded by a low, like a 3-foot wall to keep them from falling off the roof. It's a good thing. On the inside or outside of the house is a stairway to the roof, a small stairway. By passing the crowd, in verse 18, it says there were some men. There were four men that had a friend who had what they call paralytic. He basically had paralysis. He had little to no motor skills. And so the friends say, we've got to get him to see Jesus, because if he sees Jesus, something's going to happen. But they couldn't make their way into the house because it was so crammed with the religious people of the day. You had the Pharisees, you had the Sadducees, you had the doctors that were in there. And they were all in there because they knew the reputation of Jesus. And they wanted to get into this little house, and they wanted to listen to this man Jesus, who they'd already heard had healed some people, right? And they wanted to find out what this guy was all about. They were skeptical. They were thinking, there's no way this guy could really be the deal. I mean, there's no way. Matter of fact, in the first part of chapter 5 of Luke, it says Jesus cleansed a leper. The man that had leprosy was now no longer a leper. I'm sure they heard the reports of the leprosy that was removed. So here they are inside this house. And now these four guys, these best friends of this paralytic, will say, we've got to get him to Jesus. So instead of trying to make their way in the door, they carry him up the stairs onto the roof. And they get to the top of the roof, and the roof was made of different kinds of material, but they were little tiles. And they literally had to kind of start taking one tile after another and put it to the side so they could begin to create a little hole in that little place where... Now so if I'm Peter, the homeowner, and I've got a bunch of guests that are packing up my house, and I look up, and some dude is cutting a hole in my roof, I'd have looked at Jesus like, seriously? Like, what are you going to do about this? And I got a feeling as we read this passage, Jesus kind of went, shh, chill, Peter. It's going to be okay, man. So they continue on, digging a little hole into the place where they were able to lower this paralytic down in front of Jesus. And in spite of the crowded conditions, space is made for this little bed, this pallet, as it rests on the floor. Now, this is what I think possibly happened. At that moment, when the person was being lowered down into that house that was full of people and just crowded, and the midst of Jesus, I believe there was a holy hush that came in that moment, waiting to see what was going to happen. There was an expectation in that moment. What's Jesus going to do? Is he going to be ticked off for interrupting his teaching time? Verse 20, here's what happened. It said, when he saw their faith, when he saw whose faith? When he saw the four friends' faith. Listen, their friends were desperate to get him to Jesus because they needed a healing. And sometimes we don't allow the desperation we feel inside to drive us to a place where we can bring ourselves to someone or to the feet of Jesus to get the healing we need. I believe God's speaking to somebody here this morning, if not a couple of people. He's drawing you to a place where you're saying, I'm tired of my condition. I'm fed up with living for something that really is taking me no place. I'm tired of living in this place where my physical body, my physical need is limited. I need a touch from Jesus. I believe this. Your sins are forgiven. He says, man, your sins are forgiven you. Wait a minute. Why, if he was coming in the house because he had basically no motor skills, he was a paralytic, why would the first thing that Jesus do be to say to him, knowing that would bring controversy to all the teachers that are in that house, why would he say, man, your sins are forgiven you first before anything else? Many of the biblical experts would suggest that Jesus' response was indicative of his sensing the paralytic's specific, not the friends, but the paralytic's need for I think Jesus perceived that the paralytic had a deep need for spiritual cleansing. He was very concerned about his spiritual state. He couldn't verbalize it because of the motor skills issue, but the friends brought him in knowing that Jesus could heal, but he himself was concerned about the state of his heart. And so Jesus sensed that, the faith that they had, but he sensed that man's need, and he looks and he says, man, your sins are forgiven you. I like it. He took care of the thing that was more public concerning to the paralytic than his physical condition was his soul. Now, at the words of Jesus, your sins are forgiven you, the group that assembled was super irritated with Jesus. Jesus demonstrated he has the power to do a couple of things here. He has the power in that moment, in any moment, to do the invisible. Forgive a man's sins by doing something miraculous, and by doing something miraculous that they could see with their own eyes, healing his paralysis. See, verse 24, it blows them away when he says this. He says, I'm going to prove right now that I have authority from my Father in heaven. Remember John 14? He went to his Father. He has authority in heaven right now to forgive sins. And watch this. I say to you, now be free of your sins. Rise up, pick up your little mat, and get out of here and go home. Not only did he get physically touched, but now he was spiritually whole. Both things, spiritual and physical, he got them both in one moment. And that dude, it says he picked up his mat. It says this, I say to you, pick up your bed and go home. And immediately, it says he rose up before them, picked up what he'd been lying on, and went home. And here's what he said. He went home glorifying God. You can't glorify God in this case if you have no motor skills, no verbal ability to speak. So it's suggesting that he got healed of his paralysis and his soul was cleansed and he went home glorifying God on the streets of his city. That's what happens when Jesus touches a person. That's what happened when Jesus comes into a person's life. We no longer are the same. You no longer are that person that had a physical condition or a soulical condition. Jesus wants to heal that today. He wants to bring freedom to all of the children of the world, literally. I believe we're in a massive reformation as a nation. I do. And I'm not speaking in context of President Trump, although I believe God can use anyone because he puts all people in authority, whether you believe that or not. And I believe we're in a reformation place right now as a nation. And I'm going to prophesy something to you this morning because I believe with all of my heart that we're getting ready to see an awakening in the nation in the United States of America like we've never seen before. I believe God's going to begin to awaken people. Maybe some of you, maybe your family members, maybe that person that you say, hell no, they'll never get saved. Some of you freaked out because of hell. We've been talking about this a little bit, but no, the truth is there's no way in the world that person will ever respond to Jesus. I believe this awakening is coming, is indicative of what God's doing right now. See, a lot of times what happens in the natural is reflective of what's going on in the spiritual. And in the natural, God's shaking up a nation. Our nation's being shaken right now in every form, in every way possible. I believe it's because he's also shaking the hearts of the people across the United States. And I think you need to get ready because there's going to be an awakening, whether you want it or not. It's coming. There's an awakening coming, another awakening coming to America and probably the world. And many people are going to say yes to Jesus, not on Easter Sunday, but every single day of the week, 24/7, 365 days out of the year. Believe this. So here we go. Let's wrap this up. So here's what happens. He blows their minds in verse 24. He proves to them that he's God in the flesh, that he can forgive sins as well as he can heal a body. And here's where I think the trump card kind of comes in. At verse 26, we find once again an amazement. Now remember, we started out in verse 26 stating they were amazed. It seized them and it was extraordinary things that happened. Now you know why they said what they said. It was a moment of ecstasy, a moment which displaced their understanding. It doesn't say just one people. It says all. Amazement seized them all. I'm believing that every single person that was inside of Peter's home that day was struck by the reality that the man that was lowered down was no longer a person who could not speak or even use his faculties properly. He was now completely sane, talking, verbal, and his sins had been forgiven. They were in amazement of that. They were completely in awe of the extraordinary thing that had happened in that small home. And the question I ask you this morning is, what have you seen in your life? See, no longer were they gathering to listen to a man that they had heard healed people. They have now seen it for themselves. First-hand experience. No longer in story form or the whisper of someone's exaggerated rumor. It's now right in front of them, and they're messed up. They've been moved by the presence of God. When I was a kid, and I still love this game, I don't play it much anymore, but I love the game of Rook. Anybody played Rook? Right? Love the game of Rook. And there's lots of different ways you can play the game of Rook, but the way we always played it was, there was one card in that stack that was the Rook card. And if you got the Rook card, that particular card did what? It took any hand on the table. And no one ever really knew who had the Rook card because you wanted to save it to the last moment to use it to win the hand, and most of the time the game. I believe that what we read in Luke chapter 5 was a type of trump card moment when God is not limited by man's understanding of who he is. He has not made his last move yet on this nation or this world. His hand is still moving. And just when you think there's no way out of a circumstance, just when you think there's no way that my paralysis can be healed, just when you have thought that there's no way that job can change where I get a better job that pays better to take care of my family, just when you think there's no hope, God pulls out, so to speak, a trump card. And he throws it down. He says, take that. Watch this. Take up your mat. Get out of here because you're no longer the same as you were 30 seconds ago. The definition of the word trump is this: to excel, surpass, or outdo. That's my father. He wants to excel past your understanding of him. He wants to outdo anything you've ever thought of him. He wants to take you to a place you've never been to before with him. And today is a great day to make that decision to say, God, I haven't done very well following you. But today I'm going to make a new commitment. I'm going to let you be the Lord of my life, the director of my life. And anytime you want to throw a trump card down, feel free. I give you permission to use me. I think the most extraordinary thing that's ever happened in the history of the world happened 2,000 years ago. When Jesus was willing to pay a price, be brutally abused for every one of us in this room and throughout the entire world, past and present and future. Jesus died. I'm so glad he didn't stay dead. Because God the Father had a plan. Even in 2017, he had a plan. He let him go for 3 days, did some warfare, if you will. The third day, stone's been rolled away. Jesus is no longer inside that tomb because he's alive and well. That's extraordinary. What is it today that possibly paralyzes you, keeps you from walking in a place of destiny, a place of focus, a place of purpose? Because your job, your education, your friends, your titles, those things bring temporary fulfillment. They will not bring lasting joy. They will not bring you to a place where for the rest of your life, that thing that you've been seeking after is going to bring everything you think you're supposed to get. Listen, when you get to that place where you think you're supposed to be, the academic achievement, maybe the job, maybe the promotion, maybe the marriage, maybe the children, whatever, those are all wonderful things. But I promise you something, it won't be the thing that brings lasting peace and joy. The only thing that brings that is Jesus. The only thing. This morning, he wants to throw it down right now. He wants to offer us that lasting, eternal joy and hope. It only comes from Jesus. I close by saying this. He wants to move on our behalf. He wants to outdo all of our preconceived ideas of who he is and what he can do in our lives. Some of us today need his grace, his forgiveness for things we have done and continue to do. Others of you today need this same Jesus to do an extraordinary thing in your life by doing something physical in your body. He hasn't made his last move in your circumstances and eagerly awaits your invitation to welcome him home into your life. I want to pray for you this morning. a brief prayer. And I'm going to invite anyone that wants prayer this morning to come to the front. I'm going to have my team ready and willing to pray for you. And listen, you don't even have to have the faith necessarily. We'll do it for you. We'll pray on your behalf. But in the midst of that, in the midst of our praying for you, I believe that God wants to release something so profound inside of you that it will shake the very core of your being. Do. Would you close your eyes for a moment? Let me just pray for you. Father, I thank you for this day. Thank you for Easter 2017. Father, I spoke what I believe you wanted me to speak, and I've come to the conclusion that there's times I've said things and people have heard something that I didn't say, but it was because it was the thing you wanted them to hear. So this morning, God, I pray that whatever needs to be heard in the hearts of the people, whether I said it or not, may you illuminate that to their heart right now. I pray that this would be a moment in the history of their life, the moment in their life when they absolutely can look back on Easter 2017 and said, that was a day in my life when I forever changed, inside and out. Maybe this morning you're here, you say, hey, PB, I've known Jesus, man. I grew up in church, but I haven't really had this vertical relationship with him. I've just kind of been that, well, let's just call it what it is, a Western Christian. I go to church on occasion. I do it maybe Easter, Christmas, and a few other times during the year, but I don't have real intimacy with Jesus. I don't have a vertical thing with him. I've got more of a horizontal gig going. I know I'm going to do the right thing, but Jesus is calling you this morning. He's saying, listen, I want more than that. I want relationship. So if that's you this morning, say, Pastor, please pray for me. That God would just awaken my heart and my soul to intimacy with him, to a deeper relationship with him. I begin to know what we read about in Luke and John 17 and Acts 19, where extraordinary things happen in the life of the Apostle Paul and Dr. Luke and the paralytic. And for that matter, the four friends that lowered him, brought him up on the roof and lowered him down. I got to imagine those four friends were rocked that day because their faith brought him to that place where he found not only Jesus, but he found his physical healing. Who will say, hey, Pastor Barry, please pray for me today. If that's you, I promise we won't ever embarrass anybody, but lift up your hand. I just want to acknowledge you and pray for you because I believe God has got great things in store for your life. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Who else this morning say, PB, pray for me, man. I really want God to awaken. Thank you. I want to awaken my heart to a new reality of who he is. Anyone else? Listen, you can't do it on your own. I'm going to be honest. You could try. And I'm going to say something I say very rarely in here. Probably should say it more. But as much as there's a heaven, there's definitely a hell. And if you want me to be brutally transparent and honest with you, I'm going to tell you today that there will come a day when the Father will say to his Son, it's time to bring my family home. And we're all going to spend eternity with Jesus. Don't wait till you think you're on your deathbed or that last moment to say yes to Jesus. Because not only is it wrong thinking, it's also a wasted life. Because from now until that day, when whether we die here and then see him or whether we live to see him, between now and then, God has plans for your life that are so much bigger than you can ever dare to dream. Extraordinary things plan for your life. It doesn't have to be raising someone from the dead, but it can simply be, there are some people in this room, you're the most loving people anywhere, and God's called you to love a people that no one else can love, because you just ooze with this wonderful love. You think that's just you? That's God, man. So one more time, is there anybody else here say, PB, please Pray for my soul. Pray for my heart. I want to be like the paralytic, and I want to make sure I'm okay with God this morning. Anybody else? Okay, stand with me. Now, we're going to pray for whatever it is that you need, but specific to that, I believe God has highlighted some of you in your physical bodies. I believe there's someone here today that's got what we would call something with arthritis. It's affecting your joints. And the Father has highlighted you today, and he wants us to pray for that arthritic condition, that God would touch your body. Some of you are having some heart palpitations right now. It's not just simple anxiety. God's doing something inside of you, but he wants to heal your heart today. Those two things specifically, I believe God's highlighted. I think there's a third area, and it's be sensitive to this, but I won't say how many, but there's some individuals struggling with their sexual identity. God said, I've got this. I love you. You're not judged. My mercy covers that. I love you today. He's calling you. He's calling you today because he wants to show you his goodness and his kindness in your life. I believe God wants to touch some marriages here today, some relationships. Yeah. There's someone here this morning that is struggling with a deep, deep, deep fear. We're not talking the kind of fear that it spoke of in Luke 5 when they saw the paralytic made whole, and it says they stood in awe. That word awe means fear, awesome. It's a holy fear. It's like standing in amazement at what God's done. This fear is more of a phobia fear, and God is highlighting that in your life because you know who you are. And God said, I want to take that away. I want to give you the peace which surpasses all of your mental capacity. I want to bring something inside of you you've never had before. And so if that resonates within you, come today and let us pray with you. You don't have to wait till I'm done. You can just start coming if you want. That's fine. This house is super, super understanding of those things. We're just a big family. Start coming. If any of those things resonate with you, just begin to come. Don't leave today with the same condition you had.